Tonight, from the studios of WGBH Boston, NOVA presents the first national science test. And here's our master of ceremonies for tonight's test, the distinguished host of the intellectual quiz shows Jeopardy and College Bowl, Mr. Art Fleming.
Thank you very much. Thank you so much. Thank you. I appreciate it. Thank you. Good evening, everyone, and welcome to the special premiere of NOVA's 12th season on PBS, the first national science test. I'm delighted that NOVA invited me to host this event, which is designed to permit the millions of viewers in NOVA's weekly home audience to match their science wits with a specially selected studio audience and a quartet of distinguished celebrity panelists. Now, NOVA invited four eminent non-scientists to take the national science test this evening. In alphabetical order, they are, first, a noted actress of stage and screen, a four-time Academy Award nominee and Emmy Award winner for her role in Playing for Time, Miss Jane Alexander. Next is a man who has enjoyed a long and distinguished career as the chief science correspondent for ABC News, Mr. Jules Bergman. Is one of America's most famous school teachers, the founder of Chicago's West Side Preparatory School, and an outspoken champion of public literacy, Mrs. Marva Collins. And finally, but by no means least, the member of our test panel who is number fourth, the gentleman who spent 34 years as a broadcast journalist with NBC News, and authored two best-selling books on the modern use and abuse of the English language, Mr. Edwin Newman. A very distinguished panel, please be seated. Welcome, panelists, and now let me explain how the National Science Test works. The test itself will consist of a series of multiple-choice questions in five different categories: technology, life sciences, history and personality, physical sciences, and wildlife. The correct answer will be revealed after each question throughout the test, except for our special mystery scientist question, whose answer will be revealed at the end of the test. Every question and answer on the test has been beautifully illustrated with film clips from the most spectacular NOVA programs of the past 12 years. So taking the test will not only give us some ideas of how much we know about science, it'll also give us the chance to enjoy highlights from many of the best science documentaries ever made. Just moments ago, our studio audience took the National Science Test. These 100 people were specially recruited to represent a cross-section of the average NOVA viewing audience. While the studio audience test results have just been tabulated by computer, we've not yet revealed the correct answers to them. So they will be finding out how well they did throughout the program, just like everyone else. Panelists, are you ready? Fine. Good luck. Let's start the game. Let's begin the test now with a question from the history and personality category about a man whose, well, ingenuity made him an American folk hero. Watch this monitor, please.
Thomas Alva Edison is probably the most famous inventor in world history. Which of the following four machines is not an Edison invention? A, the phonograph. B, the telegraph. C, the electric vote recorder. Or D, the ticker tape. Again, which machine is not an Edison invention? A, the phonograph. B, the telegraph. C, the vote recorder. Or D, the ticker tape.
Thomas Edison, the Wizard of Menlo Park. Now time to declare your answers, players, and we will rotate the opportunity to start each round of answers. So, Jane Alexander, we will begin this round of answering with you. Which machine do you think was not invented by Edison? You say B. Any specific reason why?
I just think that he didn't invent that one.
A woman's intuition. Good enough. All right, let's see what happens now with Jules. And Jules, likewise, B.
Because I think a man named Samuel Morse was generally credited with inventing the telegraph.
All right, Marva. Likewise, B.
Likewise, B.
And a woman's intuition?
No, not really. That's one of the things that he did not.
Okay, one of the things. Edwin Newman, what do you say? Likewise, B, so we have four B's.
I would just like to top Jules Bergman here and say it was Samuel F. B. Morse.
Oh, Samuel F. B. Morse, right.
Top, Ed.
Well, this is starting early, is it not? We are learning continuously. Let's now find out what our audience, when they were polled, they picked B, the Telegraph, by 41%. Now, were we all right or wrong? Let's find out. What is the answer?
The correct answer is B, the telegraph, which was invented before Edison was born. He did, however, improve on the telegraph and developed the first microphone for use in telephones. Edison also invented an electric perforating pen, a medicine called polyform, an early type of X-ray, and the storage battery. He marketed records, talking dolls, children's furniture. He was even in the movie business.
Oh, he liked the way Mr. Thomas A. Edison, Miracle Man.
Quite a man. Edison, Miracle Man, written and performed by the legendary George M. Cohan. We had four B's, so each one of you will receive 1 point. That's a very good start. Congratulations. Let's move on now to a question about wildlife, which deals with the most important of all biological processes, photosynthesis. Again, I invite your attention to the monitor.
Plants trap sunlight and make sugar in the process called photosynthesis. This sugar supplies the energy for all life on Earth. Organisms which don't carry out photosynthesis must get their energy from those which do. Which of the following does not carry out photosynthesis? A. Seaweed. B. Mushroom. C. Venus flytrap. Or D, potato. Again, which of the following does not carry out photosynthesis? A, seaweed. B, mushroom. C, Venus flytrap. Or D, potato.
Well, Samuel F. B. Morse, Jules Bergman, it is up to you to start this round. What is your answer? You choose A. Again, why?
Because seaweed is underwater. I don't see how it could possibly do what I regard as an integral part of photosynthesis, namely giving off oxygen while it uses CO2.
That's quite a lesson in itself. Marva, what do you say?
Probably all wrong.
No, we'll see in a moment. Marva, you say A. Why?
Yes. Somewhere I seem to have read, I don't remember exactly where, that's A should be the answer.
Okay, fine. Let's hope. And Edwin, what about you? Ed's changed that to a D. Why the potato?
It doesn't seem to me that a potato is capable of
doing anything but
decline there. Yes.
Okay. Now, Jane, your decision, please.
I'm saying a mushroom, because a mushroom is a fungus, I think.
Okay, well, let's find out what happens. The audience was polled, and what did they pick? They, too, picked B, mushroom, by a total of 42%. Now, were they right or wrong? What is the correct answer?
The right answer is B, mushroom, which is a fungus, not a plant, and gets its food from decaying plant matter. Although the Venus flytrap and similar plants eat insects, they make some of their food through photosynthesis. Both seaweed and the potato plant make all their food by photosynthesis.
Well, Jane, you really came up with the winner. You get 1 point for knowing that a mushroom is not a plant, but a fungus, and doesn't carry out photosynthesis. You have 1 point, and of course, you are in the lead with 2 so far. Now comes a question about transportation from the technology category. Okay? Watch again this screen, please.
The introduction of high-speed rail service is being planned between major metropolitan areas in several countries around the world. Which of the following is the world's fastest commercial passenger train? A, the Japanese Shinkansen, also known as the bullet train. B, the West German magnetic levitation train. C, the United States Amtrak Metroliner. Or D, the French TGV or train à grande vitesse. Again, which is the world's fastest commercial passenger train? A, the Japanese Shinkansen. B, the German Maglev. C, the Amtrak Metroliner. Or D, the French TGV.
Now, Marva Collins, which do you think is the world's fastest train?
the A.
A, the Shinkansen, the Japanese, okay?
Yes.
That's your choice. Any particular reason
about
that?
Well, they seem to have done very well in the last 30 years and everything else, so I would
assume that
their train is most...
Ed, what is your choice?
I think the French, the Très Grande Vitesse.
And why do you say that?
I seem to remember having read that it had achieved higher speeds than the Japanese bullet train. One thing I'm sure about, the Metro Liner is not...
Is not the one. That always brings a chuckle, okay? Jane, now it's your choice again.
I'm going to say the Japanese, too. They like to get places fast.
Okay, now we have two A's so far and a D. And what do you say? Jules has likewise a D. Why?
I think the French Très Grande Vitesse, as Ed said, has set higher speeds experimentally than the Japanese bullet train.
Any correction on his pronunciation, Ed? No, he was all right on that one. All right, let's find out.
The master.
The audience was polled, and they came up with D, the French TGV, by 55%. Were they right or wrong? Let's see. What is the correct answer?
The answer is D, the French TGV, which traveled at 236 miles per hour in February 1981, breaking the speed record held by the Japanese Shinkansen. The German magnetic levitation train has actually gone faster than the TGV in test runs, but it has not yet carried commercial passengers. The Amtrak Metroliner reached its top speed of 162 miles per hour on the test track way back in 1963. Its highest speed on commercial runs between New York and Washington today is 120 miles per hour.
Well, Ed and Jules, you each receive a point for picking the French train. And after three questions, we find a recap from left to right. Ed has 2 points, Marva 1 point, Jules with 2 points, and likewise 2 points for Jane. On to the next question now. This one from the life sciences category about what goes on inside the human circulatory system. Again, I invite your attention. Please look at the screen.
This is a red blood cell magnified 50,000 times. Here, special photography captures red blood cells traveling through tiny blood vessels, carrying oxygen to the other body cells. How many red blood cells are produced by the human body each day? A, 200,000. B, 2 million. C, 2 billion. Or D, 200 billion. Once again, how many red blood cells does the human body produce each day? A, 200,000. B, 2 million. C, 2 billion. Or D, 200 billion.
Ed Newman, now tell me, truly amazing photography, wasn't it? Tell me, how many red blood cells do you think the human body manufactures every day?
I have no idea, so I'm choosing the highest number.
D makes a good choice. Fine. Let's see, Jay, now, your decision, please.
For the same reason, I'm choosing the lowest number.
Is that everybody's blood system or just yours that you figure only has 200,000?
Everyone's.
Everybody's. Okay, A's a fine choice. And Jules, what do you say?
2 million.
2 million. Why? What specific reason?
Well, frankly, Art, I have to confess, I failed college physiology.
That makes the two of us. And finally, Marva?
D.
D. Fine. And any particular reason for that?
I simply do not know.
You simply do not know. Fine. Now, let's see what our audience totaled up. And they picked B, 2 million. In fact, 43%. Now, let's find out exactly what was the correct answer to that one. What is it?
The answer is D. 200 billion red blood cells are produced each day. They live about 3 to 4 months, making 170,000 trips around the body. An equal number of red blood cells die each day and are disposed of by the white blood cells, or leukocytes. If all the red blood cells in a human body were stacked up like this, they'd stretch all the way around the world.
200 billion. That's amazing. Well, we had Marva and Ed with two Ds. You each receive a point. Congratulations. The score now is Ed 3, 2 for Marva, 2 for Jules, and likewise 2 for Jane. We have a pretty good game going here. Now, the next question has to do with the physical sciences, this time mathematics. So, panelists, if you remember your high school geometry lessons, you should be all set. Are you ready? Again, please watch the screen.
Geometric shapes with four sides and four corners are called quadrilaterals. One kind of quadrilateral is a trapezoid. Which of these shapes is a trapezoid? Shape A, shape B, Shape C or shape D? Once again, which shape is a trapezoid? Shape A, shape B, shape C, or shape D?
Jane Alexander, all right? Which one do you think is a trapezoid?
This is embarrassing.
No.
Let's say D.
D, and why do you say that?
Because I can't remember.
I can't either. I'm with you. Jules Bergman.
Shape B, and I too can't remember.
But that's a good letter.
I should be ashamed of myself.
No. And Marva?
Shape B.
Why do you say B?
I remember helping my son with some homework the night before last, and it's either shape B or he has received a U today.
And Ed, your choice?
I say A because it seemed to me that the shape of the trapeze on which the man on the flying trapeze did his act was the shape A.
Very unique logic. A, two B's, and a D. What did our audience pick? They picked A, shape A, by 55%. Were they all right or all wrong? Let's find out. What was the question and the answer?
The correct answer is A. Trapezoids are quadrilaterals with only two parallel sides. B is not a trapezoid because none of its sides are parallel. It's called a trapezium. C is not a trapezoid because it has two pairs of parallel sides. It's called a parallelogram. And D is called a rhombus. It's a parallelogram in which all the sides are equal in length.
Ed, you were the only one correct. Of course, you'll receive 1 point. You have 4 now, and I'm awfully sorry about your son, Marva. He has flunked. The other 3 players are with...